what I'm saying is not meant to change you from what you've heard in your lifetime, but it is what I grew up in and what I've heard in my life. The other thing I want to remind you all here, in spite of all of us who are still young, is that we're intelligent beings. Intelligence is our gift. In fact, before Columbus came here, our stories say we were the most advanced culture in the world. Because when you look at how we live, we fit right in with nature. There's no evidence that we even existed in some places. That's how close to nature we were. So we didn't destroy nature in order to exist. We coexisted with it. In fact, our existence with nature helped it flourish. You know, as a young person, your parents might ask you to go and gather dry wood for the fire. So you'd walk in the forest, you'd pick up those dry limbs that fell to the forest floor, and you would take them home. And they would use them to start your fires or end your fires. So that was our way of keeping the forest clean so that there was very few opportunities to have forest fires. So we know that we fit right into everything that we see around us in creation. But just remind us that that's how your mind works, that you're an intelligent being. There's going to be times in your life where you're going to face hardships. And we talk about that. One of the ways we say every time your life changes, if one life ends and new life begins, we call it the potential to become a gap. Say you might fall out of life during that time, or you might get lost wandering around, or you might get stuck in a repeating pattern. So what we say to you at that time is, there's a bridging. You bridge yourself into your next change, is what we say. And how you do that is with your mind. You throw your mind ahead. And then your mind pulls yourself through any time of darkness or any hard time, is what we say. So however you do that, you envision a dream, you hear a story, you look at the lives of your parents, your grandparents, your great-grandparents, and you see how they pulled themselves through their living with their own minds. Just to remind ourselves of that. And in this time, our people still survive because that's how we still are. We still use our great intelligence to survive. That's what we do. So I just want to remind you all of that. It's the intelligence of who you are is an important thing. The Creator gave us that. That's what separates us from everything. Because we don't have sharp claws. We don't have fangs. We can't run very fast. So how is it we've existed for so long is that we have our intelligence. So we talk about that. Anishinaabe people, there are three fires. Confederacy, they're called the Ojibwe, Potawatomi, Odawa. We lived on the Atlantic Ocean at one time, and a great prophecy came to told us about a newcomer who would come across the waves. And that prophecy actually sent these three people inland, that we would move away from him, that he would get to know us. So that's what we did. We migrated up the St. Lawrence River, up the chain of lakes, or the Great Lakes. We settled in the north part of Lake Superior, around Minnesota, Wisconsin, the northwestern Ontario. And where we were moving to was our prophecy said we would move to a place where the food floated upon the water. And what we were talking about at that time was Menominee or wild rice. That's actually my name. My ancestor, his name is Menominee, which means someone who looks after the rice. So my family carried that name, rice, since that time. It's called rice mostly because English don't know how to spell Menominee. We didn't spell it, so we didn't have to worry about spelling. We just said it. Menominee means a little piece of the Creator. That's what wild rice is called. And for a time in its life, it floats upon the water. So water is essential to the life cycle of Menominee. But we talk about everything that we get from our earth and how it moves in cycles, with water being really important. I know on the oceans, they have tides and then the movements that are related to the sun and the earth. In the moon, how the tides will move to that. Here on the Great Lakes, we don't have that great effect by the tide, but we're still affected by water considerably. Because where I come from, we have in the wintertime, the ice freezes, it turns to snow. We say that's how it is for us. Sometimes near the end of winter, it's a time of starvation. In our bodies, we run out of food. The food we put aside for the winter. What happens to me, say, the maple tree, in the Nautic it's called, it starts to swell. There's a word, majijawan. It means a swelling. Some of you might even be able to see that. You can see the trees, they swell like that. That happens in the springtime, right after the snow starts to melt and the ground starts to become bare. So then Majid, when it releases right after that, is the sweet water, or Zizbach dos, we call it, the maple sap. It's what it releases. And that's an important medicine, because right after the ice and the snow breaks up, we move to our camps, where we do maple sugaring, where we harvest the maple sap, and we mold it down into a Zizbach dos, little cubes of sugar. That's what we would do at that time. But before we did that, we would drink that sweet water. Because the sweet water, what it does for us, when you drink it, it thickens your blood. It helps it alleviate that thick blood and thins it out. That's what it does. And our parents used to do that when we were small, in March, when that would flow. They would make us stay inside and drink all of that. Because then we'd get the diarrhea, we'd get the runs. That would cleanse out our digestive system. Anything that's inside that sweet water, if you drink a lot of it, it'll give you the runs, it'll cleanse you. So we did that early in March in the springtime. The sweet water was around, preparing our digestive system for what's going to happen next. So after we gathered the sweet water and we turned the sugar cubes, they say the grandmothers would take that sugar and they were the ones who would store it. They would carry it all summer. And then next winter is when they would start to release it slowly to the people. And right after we had the sweet water and the gathering of the maple syrup, that many families would move another time. We would move to the mouths of the river. And where I come from, this river called the Ziguan River. It means the spring river. Or Ziguan is the spirit of the springtime. We would move to that mouth of that river. We'd harvest fish after that. Because that's what our body needed right after the starvation. We would need protein. Because our bodies would even start to need our own protein in our body. So we would harvest the fish, and they would come in different ways. The little small fish that are oily, the smelts would come, and we'd harvest those because the oils and the protein from that fish were essential. I always joke because I'm bear planting that time of year, I eat smelts because then I get a nice shiny coat after I eat those fish because they're oily. And then other fish will come in after that. The suckers would come in, the pickerel, the lake trout. They would all come in and spawn at that time, so we would harvest those. So we would eat those to build up the proteins in our body. We would also store them. We would dry them. We would dry them. We would powder them out, and we would do things to conserve them. And then after that time, we'd move into the next cycle. Usually this time of year is that cycle. Over here, we watch out for, he's called Wawa Tesi, the firefly. When you see the firefly, you know, then that's the time, that's a warning, we're all going to be really busy after he gets here. Because what he does is he flies around and he lands on the back of the deer. Before he touches the deer has a slate-colored fur. And as soon as he touches the deer turns a reddish color. That means that he's ready. And people who know the taste of venison, that's the time of year he's full of nutrients. And he actually tastes the best at that time. The fireflies are out and they touch them. But also at that time, a lot of other things happen. And the strawberry or hardberry has medicine for your heart. Because over the winter time, if your heart has suffered any damage, that's when you would eat that berry. The leaves of that berry would make your heart strong. Again, because we're getting ready to do lots of work. So we'd start gathering. We started gathering birch bark. We need to build our summer lodges, or we need to gather birch bark to make canoes or to make vessels, boxes, and those kinds of things. Because the swelling of the birch bark at that time, you just had to slip the tree and the bark would just pop off the tree and make itself available to us. And there were other trees at that time, the elm tree. We would gather that one. We usually use that one for our wigwams because it's a harder, stronger bark. So there was a lot of harvesting. And one of our sacred medicines that happens at that time is sweet grass. So you'd gather that sweet grass and you would harvest it and braid it, and you would have that for the upcoming winter year. If you ever have sweet grass, you can hang it in your home. It's like it's our weather network. Eh? You know it's going to rain because you can really smell it. It would let us know when rain was going to happen. So sometimes we would just hang it in our home so we could see what the weather was going to do. But after that time, we would move out. We would move away from those areas and move out to places where we would pick berries in various islands around here. Some inland places, we'd pick those cluster berries next. The blackberries, the raspberries, and all those berries. Each one, they help us with our digestion. Each berry helps, you know, helps us process our food. They go to those organs that help us do that. So one of the things they say, especially about the blackberries, they're really good for our digestion, but if you eat too much, they can bung you up. A little seed will block you up, you'll become constipated. So you have to be careful. It's always too, when we harvest something, it's about moderation. Taking what you need and storing the others for the upcoming winter. So that's what we would do. And then another time after we gathered the berries, gather a big time too was gathering blueberries. Blueberries were important to us. We did a lot of things with it that would help keep our blood clean if we needed that. So we processed that. Also, we use that for the color of flows. We color that. Our word for blue actually comes from the blueberry. Minande. Minande is a blueberry. So we would use it for many things. Then after that, in middle to late August, we would move forward to our wild rice grounds. The families would have their own areas where they'd harvest wild rice. What you do is you'd go along in your canoe and you would form the plant over and you'd hit it with a stick. And the kernels or the grains would fall to the bottom of the canoe. That was a really cool process. There were songs that went with harvesting. There were songs that went with processing it. And that's what we would do. We would gather that for the whole year. I forgot to mention back earlier on in the spring, we would plant a mandamin for the corn. The corn is a gift that came to us. There's a story behind it, how a father didn't believe that his son had finished the vision quest. He made his son stay there. And his son stayed there too long, so the creator took his son to the spirit world and left in his place the corn for the mandamin. So that's how the corn came to our people. So we would plant that, and then it would grow. And we had acres of it at one time. When the Europeans came here, they didn't believe that Ojibwe farmed, but we had lots of corn to the plant. So after we gathered the wild rice, we had that for the food. We would again start gathering the other plants, squash, corn, and other things we grew. And all along the time, there were natural medicines we would pick and use those and harvest them at the same time. We have to remember nature gives us a lot of food. It's our supermarket. You could walk out there and you could eat. In fact, there was a study from the early 1900s. It basically said that indigenous people here at that time, we ate anywhere from 500 to 600 different food items over the course of a year. So we ate a lot of things that the earth gave to us. So we didn't have a Thanksgiving holiday like we taught Europeans. When we harvested, we had Thanksgiving every night for the day. If you harvest something during the day, we would celebrate that harvest so that we could harvest again the next morning. There was this famous ethnologist, his name was Francis Dinsmore. He went to spend time with the Ojibwe in Minnesota, and he was there during ricing season. What he wrote after his experience with them was he was kind of disgusted with us. He said those Ojibwes would have harvested more rice if they didn't celebrate every night. He forgot to understand that concept of appreciation and gratefulness. That's what we're doing every night. We're being grateful for what the Creator gave us. So our cycle, there are many things in there that we gathered as the season went by, so that in the late fall, we started hunting again. We started gathering protein. We started storing it. And what we would do is we were digging holes and we would pile rocks on top of things. And we would have caches, they're called. We would bury food items in places we wouldn't know where they were, so that we could return them to them in the winter. We could harvest, we could get dried meat or dried fish, dried berries, a lot of rice, the corn, the things that we needed. We would bury those and return to those as we needed them. So that's what a lot of the work in the fall and during the year was, getting ready for the winter. So we say now what happens, one of the last things we eat and we harvest is the cranberry. The cranberry, that berry just before it gets to be winter. We wouldn't harvest that because that's the medicine we need for your liver. The liver is what's going to suffer when you come to winter. You need a strong liver so that you can survive the starvation. So the cranberry is the last one. So we say in this modern time, if you can't get out and do all the harvesting of what's happened to our environment by the newcomer or by where you live. At least follow the berries. Over this way, what we would say is you eat the strawberries and then the raspberries, and the blackberries, other kinds of berries, the blueberries, all the way through the cranberries. If you eat those as you, the seasons, they come into season, then you're at least looking after your organs. Those are inside you that keep you strong. So then in the fall, they say when the first snowfall comes, just before it snows, we have what's called a memorial feast. We give thanks to all the spirits who provided everything to us, even the spirits of our ancestors, because we believe when the snow goes on the ground that those all go to rest. They go away and they rest for the winter. So we have that one celebration. And then over this way, we would return to our wintering grounds. Where I come from, there's a deer yard about an hour inland from my community. It's called Bracebridge. But there's a massive deer yard there. In the wintertime, of over 10,000 deer go and spend the winter there. So we would all move in there. And we would have deer available to us for the wintertime. But when the snow came in, it was time for just to sitting around and listening to what we call the Otsokan. That's when the elders would be giving teachings and telling stories. It was all about staying inside the wigwam and listening to this education. That was our school. It began when the snow was on the ground, and it ended when the snow melted. My community, we called it the season of the bear. When the bear was hibernating, it was a time for us to have education. So that's what would happen all winter. And the funny thing is, even though we stored food, we would have feasts. We would have celebrations. We wouldn't forget about that aspect. But as much as we could, we would be aware of what we needed to share. And that's where they say the grandmothers came in. Every resource we had, our grandmothers put that into 28 units. There were 28 specific units for everything. 28 grains of corn, 28 grains of rice, 28 cubes of sugar. Everything was broken down into 28. And it was the grandmothers who decided where that would go. Because Anishinaabe, that was our economy. Our economy was food. And the grandmothers, the women, were the bankers. They looked after that. So they would say, you know, 4 grains of corn or 4 kernels of corn would go to the harvesters. We would have that in the harvest. We would eat it. 4 grains of corn might go to, putting away. Each family might put that away. And then another portion of grains, we would put that aside for trade. We might take some corn or we might take some wild rice south to train the Iroquois for some tobacco or something we need over the winter. So all the way through, those portions will be broken down right until the last two grains of anything we say were the grandmother's portions. That was for the grandmothers if they ever needed it. And in times of starvation and hard times, that's the kindness of our grandmothers. And this is one of our most powerful teachings. Usually when it came to the point where only the grandmother's portion was left, they always shared their portion. They always did that. It was in their nature. So we're reminded even of that generosity of our elders and those ones who look after us, that they would share theirs, even though it was meant for them. So what happened in the wintertime, we would run out of food sometimes and then we would start starving. Sometimes it's so hard that we can't eat the deer because the deer starts eating cedar, right? And its meat has a bad taste. And some animals get wormy at the end of winter, so we can't eat them. So we went through some starvation near the end of winter. So there were times, maybe for, it wasn't a long time, maybe a week or two, that we had some time where we had very little. So again, the whole season started over again, when the maple syrup started to run. And that's when we began that whole cycle of rebuilding our lives. And that's the way we are. We're cyclical people, you know, from sunrise to sundown to the next day. That's a cycle we understand is called a day. We live that day every year, every day. And then there's the lunar cycle, the 28 days our grandmother goes through. Her cycle affects both men and women. Women have that time. Men have their time too at that same time. Us men have forgotten about that. One of my teachers says that man needs a cedar bath once a month. He'll find that day. He has to experiment, whether it's the full moon, one of the crescents, or the halfway, or the new moon. When he finds that time, he needs his bath. It's when he'll have his cedar bath. It's for his own vitality. So then we talk about the seasonal cycle. We've just gone through from springtime to the summer to the fall into the winter. Our bodies are used to that cycle because we're cyclical people. And even though we don't live that way now, you're still that way. You know, it's only been maybe two, three, maybe four generations since you've lived that way. It's not too long ago, right? So that's what we need to remember. So you're moved by that cycle still. Sometimes your moods or your energy, your body still remembers all of that. So for Anishinaabe people and some other people, we used to move six times a year because we would harvest things. So our bodies are used to that. We're used to that. There'll be times a year where you might be feeling edgy. You might feel like you need to do something. One of our education counselors years ago, he noticed that the students were dropping out at specific times of year. So he talked to our old people, and they talked about why that might be. And sure enough, it was during those times when our people would move. Maybe our students would feel like they had to move, but they didn't really remember why. So what they did was they became uncomfortable with school. So they left school. But not really remembering that was maybe a time when we moved to the winter lodges, or we moved to the sugar bush, or we moved to other places. So that's in our cycle. It's still in your physiology, because we did that for thousands of generations. We just didn't change in one generation. We have to remember that. And you hear those terminologies, eh? Blood memory, spirit memory. Eh? That's what they all talk about. And even when we talk about genetics, eh? You're genetically programmed to fit into the year, fit into these cycles. Your body demands certain things at certain times of year. So whenever you start feeling uncomfortable or some kind of discomfort, you know, go home to your nations and ask them about those stories. What were we doing at this time here? It will give you a clue as to maybe what's making you edgy. And we're influenced physiologically, because we're influenced physiologically. Sometimes our thinking and our mind is influenced by what our people used to do. That's something that's not lost. It's still part of us. So that's one of the things we remind ourselves, by what came to us through our mother, the earth, through Akiqua, through the seasons, and everything the Creator gave to us. That's really short. There's a lot more within all of that that we would know. Like even 1 month, there would be a lot to talk about. But that's how we would be in the earth. And even nowadays, I just want to remind you, you still have that physiology of what modern science calls a Paleo-Indian. Paleo-Indianism. In fact, there's a fad diet called Paleo diet. It actually imitates the way we used to eat before we had fast food, before we had white sugar, white flour, okay? Before we had those processed foods. That's what they call that. So for us, that's really important. And again, we talk about, you know, when you remember, we could eat maybe 500, 600 different items a year. Nowadays, maybe we're eating 40, maybe 30, maybe only 50. So our people are malnourished. We're undernourished. Right? And you see that. You see that, and we talk about that type 2 diabetes, talk about that cancer happening to us a lot. And even some of those things that are happening with our thinking, that thinking is influenced by what we eat. So that's just to remind you, just because you don't live the way our ancestors did in the natural way, your physiology is still adapted to that. So that can influence how you think, how you feel. So as best you can, if you can look at our there's a big thing now, a movement called food sovereignty amongst our people, eh? Regaining our traditional food, way of eating food. So that's a good thing to look at. And our young people are really pushing that, are really driving for that. So I'm really happy with what some of the young people are doing nowadays. And they're really pushing us to be in a good way about who we are.
So I guess what called to me was just like relating to liking nature, because it's really calm and very serene and peaceful, and it's very aesthetic. It's pleasing to the eye. But yeah, that's me.
I feel really well rested when I like take a walk. Like, it doesn't matter how long the walk is, as long as they like take a walk.
So I got the opportunity to go back to my hometown this weekend, and one thing I want to do is hear more stories about my land and everything, and I want to learn more of my language and spend more time with my grandparents who could teach me more about the land.
We'll do our very best to help you on that journey. And one of the things that's really important to us is to support young people in making those cultural connections, because we know culture is a protection. It's the way in which we heal and grow, and it's a protective factor. So one of the things we stand strongly is the young people's desire to make those cultural connections or go home to their communities and their lands and have those experiences as well. So if there's ways that we can walk alongside you and support you and help you find your voice, or help you as you want to, you know, as you're needing a little bit of a boost, that's what we're there for.